afternoon. We're very pleased to have all of you with us today for our first free Lunchbox lecture. I'm going to have my glasses. We're pleased to have David Hudson with us today. David is very near and dear to our heart here at Panola College. He's one of our alumnus. He is also an alumnus of the University of Houston, where he graduated with a Bachelor of Arts degree in history. And he claims to be an aspiring historian. I consider him already a historian. He's also a member of Phi Theta Kappa and Phi Alpha Theta Honor Societies. He says he's propelled by an insatiable desire to critically examine historical narratives. He is actively seeking and applying to graduate programs in pursuit of academic tenure as a professor of history. He's an avid reader, whose interests span, but are not limited to, the study of African-American history, African literature, Atlantic world studies, comparative religions, post-colonial independence movements, post-colonial literature, South American history, and U.S. history. He enjoys traveling, reading, and public speaking, for which we are very grateful. Please help me welcome Mr. David Hudson.
I think my voice is loud enough to project, so I don't have to stand in front of this microphone the entire time. I made this important. The first thing that I would like to say is that some of the things that are going to be discussed, like race, tend to be sensitive topics for some people. But being that this is a college and we are, this is a collegial atmosphere, no one should be fearful of asking questions or of being wrong, because this is what you learn. So if something strikes a nerve in here, that's okay. I wasn't always comfortable learning some of the things that I'm about to share, and it takes time. It takes time when your views are challenged. It can be a painful process, but it's also enlightening and it's fulfilling as you grow. So please try and bear with me. That goes for members of the community as well. If you feel offended by something that I may have said, feel free to come and address me afterward. I'm not intentionally trying to offend anyone. I'm just trying to present information that I've learned. And I'm still learning. I don't know it all. I don't claim to know it all. So if I err in any way, please feel free to approach me and let me know. If you have any information to share with me, I'm open to it. With that said, let's get started. But the way that I want to approach this, I know that Black History Month people are used to hearing stories about people. I'm not here to really tell you stories about individuals. I really want us to really get a grasp and a feel for the collective contribution of African Americans in the history of this country. So some individuals will be mentioned, but it will be in the context of their greater contributions to this country. First of all, does anyone know who this man is? Does anyone recognize this picture? That's correct. Can anyone tell me who Dr. Carter G. Woodson is or was?
Well, basically, I know him as being a writer, author, and pretty much I'm familiar with the book he wrote as far as the, I think, with the miseducation.
That's correct. That's one of many books that he wrote. He was an author, a historian, a scholar, an educator, and he was a historian. He's also credited with being the father of Black History Month. He was born, a little background information about him. He was born in Virginia, died in D.C. His occupations before he even got into educational history. He worked as a sharecropper. He was the son of ex-slaves. He didn't even start his formal education until his late teens. That's high school. Then he went on to college, starting with Rural College in Kentucky. And what I found interesting, on their website, they say he graduated in 1903. But for students, this is the only college I've ever seen in this country. This is just a little side note. The only college I've ever seen in this country that does not charge tuition. If you get accepted there, all students graduate debt-free. So some of y'all might want to look into that. You go to a four-year law school. earned his BA and his master's from the University of Chicago. He was the second African-American to earn a PhD from Harvard, behind Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois, who was another historian, sociologist, civil rights activist. He founded the Association for the Study of Negro Life and History, which is now known as the Association for the Study of African-American Life and History. It's still in existence today, and they pretty much lead the programs dealing with directly the themes of African American History Month. And I call it Black History Month because that's what we called it when I grew up. But over the years, Black and Negro and Afro-American had been used within their respective eras due to political correctness, because presidents make addresses every year talking about African American History Month, recognizing its celebration. This year's theme we're not going to get into, but just so you know, this year's theme for African American History Month is dealing with the education crisis in the Black community. So before we get into Black history, African American history, we're Africans first. African American history has its origins in Africa. And a common misconception about Africans, and I came into an encounter here on this campus. I was introduced to a historian. I'm not gonna name any names because I'm not trying to put anyone on the spot. But there was a guest that came, I was introduced to by another historian, to this man as a historian, and we had a conversation behind closed doors, but he said, before the Europeans came in contact with the Africans, they were living in the Stone Age. And I kind of just scratched my head. I'm like, how do you make it through college and you still assert an idea that way? You're still disseminating information that's false. So the first thing that I could think of that came to mind, well, the ancient Egyptians had metal weapons. They had chariots. So they had bronze weapons. So how could you assert that these people lived in the Stone Age? And then with their monumental structures that were built, how do you cut stone with stone? If you look at a pyramid, I think it'd be very difficult to cut those large blocks of stone with stone. So I found this map that highlights different empires and civilizations on the continent. This is not all of them, and the boundaries are not, they're approximate. Some of them I know to be incorrect on here. But to give you an idea that before Africans came in contact with Europeans, and even after, there were civilizations that thrived for centuries. So we have, like I said, Black history is rooted in African history. Millions of Africans were transported to the Americas in the transatlantic slave trade. We should already know this. But I realize that a lot of this information is not being taught in schools anymore. I didn't learn a lot of this stuff in school. I had one African American history class, like my sophomore year in college. A lot of my background in African American history came from my upbringing in the church. We had a small library in our church that had books for children about stories that I found fascinating about Harriet Tubman and Frederick Douglass. And that kind of led me on a quest to learn more. But when I realized that African-American history was rooted in African history, then my interest as a student in college shifted towards African history, because I was more interested in who my ancestors were before they arrived here, because the narrative that we give here is that our history began with slavery, which is absolutely false. So there were several major civilizations in Africa prior to the commencement of this transatlantic slave trade. Some of the civilizations that I'm going to mention, the most notable is Egypt. I think we should all recognize that. And some people will try and argue that Egypt is not a part of Africa. That's obviously on the continent of Africa. If you look at the depictions of the people that you see in Egypt, they mostly look Arab. But people that I've spoken to that have actually traveled, especially when you get to the southern portion of the country, they're darker than me. So it's really something that I would encourage you all to look into for yourself, and not just take your knowledge from one single source on anything that I'm talking about. Don't just read one book or listen to what one individual tells you. You're not going to get the entire story from one source. That's a very dangerous thing to do. Some other notable kingdoms in Africa, the Kingdom of Kush, which was located in East Africa, the present-day country of Sudan. The Empire of Aksum, which encompassed the modern-day countries of Eritrea, of parts of Ethiopia, Djibouti, and Yemen on the Saudi Arabian Peninsula. You have the Zulu Empire, which King Shaka Zulu was very famous for fighting the British in South Africa. the Fulani Empire, which was in parts of Senegal, Nigeria, and Cameroon on the west coast of Africa, and this area over here. Kenbono, which is in Borno in Central Africa. Futa Jalon, I had put on here, was, I thought I had it on here, but Futa Jalon, yes, it is, it was in modern-day Guinea, was a small state. It was a small Islamic state, but I put it on this list because there was a story of a man named Prince Ibrahim Rahman Sori, who was a prince. He was a prince of Futa Jalon that was captured in war, sold in slavery in Mississippi in the 19th century. And it took him 40 years to gain his freedom, but what's significant about this man is the knowledge that he brought to Mississippi made his owner rich. He had prior knowledge of cultivating cotton. They had already been doing this in Africa for hundreds of years. He taught this man how to develop his land and cultivate cotton with knowledge that he had learned from his kingdom. So I digress, I don't want to get too far into that. But these are just some civilizations. You can see the map one more time, without any of the words in the way, just to get an idea of where these places were. The majority of people that ended up in the Americas came from Central Africa and West Africa, but the majority of the ones came from this region in what's modern-day Angola. The majority of them ended up in Brazil. The United States only absorbed about maybe 10% of the Africans that were captured and sent over to the Americas. The rest of them went into the West Indies and South America. Another large empire was the Empire of Mali, which was the second in a succession of three major empires in West Africa. You had Ghana being the first, Mali being the second, and Songhai being the third. Now, I put them up here to show that they were so important that Forbes recently named their king Mansa Musa as the richest man in the history of the world. This man devalued the price of gold for a couple of years when he made a pilgrimage to Saudi Arabia. He was another Muslim. As he passed through Egypt and other areas, he gave away so much gold, it devalued gold for years. So that right there in itself is proof that there were civilizations that were extraordinary, that existed prior to European contact with Africans on the continent. And they traded ostrich feathers, coconut nuts, gum resins, hides, and people as minor trade items, but gold was what they primarily traded, and salt was what they were looking for, because salt you need to live in. They were not able to obtain it in large amounts. The Kingdom of Congo was in the Central African region, where the majority of the Portuguese shipped out Africans to the Americas. Okay. And they traded metal hides, salt, ivory, and fabrics. So now we're going to get back to the Americas, back to Dr. Woodson. Dr. Woodson stated once that if a race has no history, it has no worthwhile tradition, it becomes a negligible factor in the thought of the world. I think this idea, this spirit, is what drove him to advocate for Negro History Week, which was first instituted in 1950, when he formed his ASALH, the Association for African American Life and Studies. So, like I said, it was founded to highlight the contributions of African Americans in the U.S., but now it's getting to the point where it's having a global influence, and we're starting to see African peoples, descendants of African peoples in different countries, starting to recognize their history and their contributions to their nations. I think on a global perspective, that African Americans contribute in a global perspective in addition to the foundation of this country, because you had African Americans that fought every major conflict in this country from the beginning of this country up until the present conflicts now. Large amounts of African Americans fought in the major wars. In the Revolutionary War, they fought on both sides. And after the Revolutionary War, the ones that, even though the British lost, they promised freedom to the escaped enslaved people that came and fought for them. Lord Dunmore was probably the most popular or notable British leader of African Americans. And he had a group called Lord Dunmore's Ethiopian Regiment. You can look it up when you have time. They fought, lost, but they actually did free them and sent them to Nova Scotia, Canada. So you had African Americans that went to Canada in addition to the ones that escaped slavery fleeing north, went to Canada. So they affect the history of Canada. after that, that there were some, I guess, that didn't really fare well in Canada. I don't know if it was the weather. They weren't able to use their agrarian backgrounds to farm because there wasn't a lot of arable land. A lot of them ended up in Sierra Leone. The British moved them to Sierra Leone, which was another colony in Africa founded for freed Africans from various parts of the British Empire. So in that effect, you had African Americans that affected Canada and West Africa. Right south of Sierra Leone, the western coast of Africa, was Liberia in 1947. That was a colony founded by African-American expatriates, African-American ex-slaves. Some of them were freed, some of them were former enslaved people. Others were just Africans that were captured and tried. They attempted the settlement of slavery after the ban that the British put on importation of slaves into the western, into the Americas, after the early 19th century, 1806, 1807, roughly. And they would, the United States funded that whole colonization project with the intent of sending the captured Africans that were en route to the United States back to Africa. So Negro History Week was first instituted in 1926. The students at Kent, now I thought this was very interesting. Students at Kent State, I didn't know this until the other day. The Black Union, the United Students at Kent State University in Ohio were the first ones to celebrate Black History Month before it was nationally recognized. They recognized Dr. Woodson's vision to expand Negro History Week to a month. Now, President Gerald Ford in 1975, 5 years later, issued the first message on the observance of Black History Week because it had not yet been recognized to be Black History Month yet. And his whole thing was that it was important for all Americans to recognize the contributions of African Americans to the foundation of this country. It was expanded to Black History Month by the I'll just call it the Association because I get tired of going through the letters, but the Association. And for more details, I have a website up here where you can actually go to the ASALH website and look at their themes for years to come, their history, if you're interested in that. If anybody has any questions about any sources or any websites that I have, you can write your email address in a book that I have up here, and I will email you whatever that you request. The first national observance of Black History Month was in 76, and Ford delivered the message concerning the first observance of Black History Month in 76. It was in 86, 10 years later, Congress passed a public law of the Institute of National Black History, or at the time, Afro-American History Month. Now, I would like to get into the early history of the country, into the colonial area. A lot of people think that all black people were enslaved at different times. No, you had free African Americans. Granted, they weren't granted full citizenship until the passage of the 14th Amendment in 1868, but you did have African Americans that were free, owned property, that participated, like I said, in wars. One of them was a man named Anthony Johnson. In primary source documents, you can see his name as Antonio A. Negro. Now, we don't know if he was a slave or an indentured servant, but he was. This was in the early 17th century. He was brought, from what I remember, from the West Indies to Virginia. And he worked for a time and then was able to buy his own freedom. He earned his freedom and then subsequently bought his wife's freedom. Now I did see in a primary source document, a journal muster of the inhabitants of Virginia in 1625, he's listed as a servant. Like I said, historians are kind of back and forth. There's contention among that claim, but I think it's a minor detail. Like I said, he bought his wife's freedom and obtained his own. After which he amassed 250 acres and he raised livestock for a living in Virginia and Maryland. As opposed to farming tobacco, he got away from that and raised livestock. Now, what's interesting about him, the reason I brought him up, is because, for one, you see that this is almost unheard of, amassing 250 acres, but this is a free black man that owned the land. Later on, what happened, like I said, that African Americans that were free they did not have full citizenship rights. He bequeathed 50 acres of land to his son Richard, who later lost that land in court. So that is proof to, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to show you a history of the way that African Americans have been oppressed in this country. And then we're going to bring this into a modern context when we get towards the end of the lecture. So after he died, the British Crown took his land. I want to know who knows who this man, who this picture is supposed to be of, because obviously there's no photograph. Hold on, Brother Omwali. I know you know a lot of this. Does anybody besides Brother Omwali have any idea who this individual might be? No one? You want to take a shot at it?
Well, sometimes I think I do it. I know it's fake. I don't really.
You should know his face. Every American in here should know his face. Because this man was largely responsible for the fervor that ended up sweeping the colonies that gained more support for the American Revolution after the Boston Massacre. This is the American patriot. Named Crispus Attucks.
Yeah.
Does anybody know the story behind Crispus Attucks in brief?
Well, basically, after that Crispus Attucks, he was one of the students that actually led the and fought the revolution with George Washington. In the sense that he brought the 5,000 slaves that they had, and they put them at the front of the battle with the British, and they are actually the ones who were actually the upfront gun battles and war that they led.
You got part of it right.
Yeah, I mean,
he was at the front of a gun battle. Yeah. That's for sure. He was the first person to fall.
Oh, and died in the revolution.
In the revolution, in what was called known as the Boston Massacre. So he's credited by patriots, by Americans, as being the first to fall, the first martyr. But he was accused of starting a riot by the British. I've actually read like court transcripts, and it's funny to see how patriots versus redcoats testified against him. Somebody said he threw a stick and hit one of the soldiers. They were apparently challenging the redcoats to a fist fight. Hey, put your guns down, you men. Like, put your guns down. They were upset about impressment. That was an impressment was a British tactic that they used when they would come into port cities and kidnap what would later be Americans. They would kidnap colonists and put them on ships and force them to serve in the British Navy. So back in those days, a common job for enslaved people and free black people were working as stevedores. You move freight on the docks. Shipbuilders as well. If you've ever read the biography of Frederick Douglass, he was leased out to a shipbuilder in Baltimore, I believe. So I do know that there's evidence of African Americans having worked in those areas. With that said, I can see why he would be upset with the British presence in Boston at the time. And he was one of the first to die. And subsequently, other patriots, specifically the Sons of Liberty, which is a very well-known colonial American group, used his death as a propaganda tool to gain more of a following for their cause for liberty. Now, I would like to read something that W.E.B. Du Bois wrote in his book called The Gift of Black Folk, which pretty much kind of gives you an account from the colonial times up until World War I of contributions of African Americans and Africans in the foundation of this country. And he has it detailed in here. It was a Negro in a sense. Began the actual fighting. In 1750, William Brown, Farmington of Massachusetts, advertised three times. A mulatto fellow, about 27 years of age, named Crispus, 6 feet, 2 inches high, short curled hair. This runaway slave was the same Crispus Attucks who in 1770 led a mob on the 5th of March against the British soldiers at the celebrated Boston Massacre. Now, Du Bois also writes that 3 days later after this massacre on the 8th, a public funeral of the martyrs took place. The four victims were deposited in one grave on which a stone was placed with the inscription, "He's one of the four." Long as in freedom's cause, the wise contend, dear to your country shall your fame extend, while the world the lettered stone shall tell, where Caldwell, Attucks, Gray, and Maverick fell. He's buried with three other patriots, and there are accounts that I've read that he was not the only black man that was present at this altercation. So I felt that in itself was an important event in the foundation of this country because it sparked the revolution. So there were other free African Americans in the colonies in the early republic. Another one that's notable is Paul Kuffy. Now Paul Kuffy was born a free man. He was born on an island off the coast of Massachusetts called Cuttyhunk. Paul Koufi worked as a merchant marine. He worked as a sailor. He was a whaler. He was also a member of the Quakers. He was an abolitionist. He ended up becoming a ship's captain, and then with his brother owning a shipping company, and I don't mean a few ships, he had a fleet of ships. This was a free black man we're talking about in the 1780s. He died in 1817. Now, what's notable about him, before I get to this right here, what's notable about Paul Koufi is that in the interest of my studies, I specialized in studying the colonization movement, which was a movement for the American people and government to try and figure out what to do with all the free black people once we free them. Because they figured there'd be a lot of bloodshed once you free a bunch of slaves that you've been oppressing for hundreds of years. So there was a movement to try and send them to different parts of the world so that there would not be a large threat to the white population. Not just that, but there would be a lot of competition for jobs in the workforce. And people knew that. Now you have to pay these people upon freeing them. So there was a movement. And he's important in that movement because before his death, on one of his ships, he took 38 African-Americans to Sierra Leone and helped them settle in with the British colony in Sierra Leone, which gave the American Colonization Society, which was largely responsible for the foundation of the country of Liberia, which became the American colony that the place that they ended up, America bought the land, a private organization of Americans, bought land on West Africa, the colony of Liberia, at gunpoint. They held one of the local kings, a naval officer held one of the local kings at gunpoint and forced him to sell some land that started the colony for about roughly $300 worth of trade goods. So he's the largely important for inspiring the ACS to implement this plan to remove African Americans from the country, because they saw him transport people that willingly wanted to go, and the ACS wasn't forcing African Americans, they were trying to convince them to leave. So that is why I brought him up. Now another thing that I found was that since we participated in every major conflict, it doesn't really get taught. It's not really in the books, but when you find books that other historians have written, they can be older books, or references in newer books, you'll always find, especially from foreigners, foreign military personnel, foreign officers, lauding, applauding, appreciating, extolling the works, the courage, the bravery, and sacrifices of African Americans in battle. In a book that I found that was written in the early 19th century, a historian named George Livermore quotes a Revolutionary War surgeon who was a former governor of Massachusetts named William Eustis. He said in a speech in front of the House of Representatives, this is what he said: at the commencement of the Revolutionary War, there were found in the middle and northern states many blacks and other people of color capable of bearing arms. A part of them free, the greater part slaves. The freemen entered the ranks with the whites. They discharged their duty with zeal and fidelity. Basically, they were very enthusiastic and they were very courageous, is what he was saying. He said this in front of the House of Representatives. I've never seen that in a textbook. I've never heard an instructor tell me this. I've never heard a high school teacher tell me this. Has anyone heard half of anything that I've told you in any of your grade school courses, high school courses, any of your survey courses in your history classes that you take now? None of you students that are currently here?
No.
Well, I'm glad that you're here to listen, and I hope that it will inspire you to start looking into some of this before. I mean, after. I don't know what else. Okay. I'll down with that. Okay, so now I want to also speak about the Haitian Revolution, which is, why are you speaking about the Haitian Revolution? That's another country. There was a largely disseminated and widespread belief that African Americans were docile, lazy in this country, and that was an excuse to oppress African Americans and keep them enslaved. But the Haitian Revolution, I think, did a large favor to counter that notion, because for 13 years, from 1791 to 1804, Africans on the island of Hispaniola, on the western half of what's now known as Haiti, fought the French. After learning about the ideas that sparked the French Revolution and the rights of men, they decided to stand up and fight the French. Now, this affected America in many ways. The first way that I thought of was Louisiana Purchase. The Louisiana Purchase occurred in 1804. 1803, right before Napoleon lost. Right before Napoleon lost the war, he decided to sell a large chunk of this country, was virtually doubled in size, $15 million, because he was afraid of losing parts of the empire. In addition to that, the merit and the bravery of these soldiers, because I've read accounts that the French said these guys were fearless in battle to the point where instead of surrendering, they'd walk into flames before they surrendered to the French. The Americans knew that Africans and their descendants were capable of fighting, and they had proven themselves here. This revolution scared the bejesus out of a lot of Americans, especially Southern slaveholders, because they figured that if they got word of this battle, they'd have to worry about slaves organizing an army here and the same thing happening here. So in that sense, the Haitian Revolution directly affected America, because when it came time for the Civil War, you had people keeping this is still fresh in the minds of Americans, and eventually African Americans were given guns. It was in part out of desperation, but it was also in part out of the fact that people had known that they were what they were capable of. It was just being denied to justify the oppressive nature of the country. Civil War, 1861 to 1865, we had the 1st South Carolina Volunteers Unit of the Union Army. Runaway slaves from South Carolina and Florida comprised this unit. Now, I'm not sure if they or the Massachusetts 54th were the first, but these were people that were willing to fight and die in the Civil War for their own freedom. First war that African Americans fought for their own freedom as opposed to for the nation or other causes. The 54 suffered heavy losses in battle, but you had people that won medals of honor after the Civil War. I think about 16 won Medal of Honor after the war. They earned their respect, even though they lost the battle, they earned respect for the race, for the entire race of African Americans in the country. And in the entire war, you had approximately 180,000 blacks that fought for the Union Army. That's 10% of the army. The 13th and 14th Amendments were passed as a result of the Civil War, abolishing slavery and admitting and granting citizenship to African Americans. So we had Reconstruction. After the Civil War, we had a period of Reconstruction, which basically was the United States trying to reintegrate the Southern states back into the country. And you had African Americans that were granted rights finally for the first time, the right to vote through the Civil Rights Act of 1866, the right to enter participation in political process. We had black senators for the first time. We had blacks participating in local politics. And that was all a result of the efforts of African Americans and other Americans in the Civil War. Now, the thing that was significant about Reconstruction is it took federal troops to actually come into the South to enforce these laws. Law enforcement has always been a big issue for African Americans, because although laws are passed on the books, it's kind of iffy how they're enforced. In this event, you had to have the federal government come in and enforce the law for example, 2 years after the Emancipation Proclamation, which was an executive order, which is kind of something similar, and it probably as controversial as what President Trump's done with his travel ban, but in a totally different context, was issued freeing all slaves in the South. But for some reason, there were people in Texas that didn't know this, or they didn't want their slaves to know. So the federal troops came 2 years later, after the fact, to Galveston, Texas, to inform slave owners and enslaved people that they'd been freed for 2 years. So that is an example of how enforcement of laws has been kind of an iffy and shaky thing, starting back in the 19th century, and it really has been that way. Really go back to Anthony Johnson, you can see it back then. The Jim Crow era followed Reconstruction from 1877 to 1965. That's in some of your lifetimes, 1965. Can anyone briefly tell me what Jim Crow was, what the Jim Crow era was about?
Equal but separate.
Separate but equal.
Separate but equal, yes.
What about you? Any of you have any idea what Jim Crow is?
Mm-hmm.
Racial segregation.
Racial segregation was a big part of it. Jim Crow is defined by, as defined by the university, Ferris State University. They have a museum of, like, I think it's a racist memorabilia, Jim Crow and racist memorabilia. So they specialize in studying this, and they find Jim Crow as the name of a racial caste system which operated primarily but not exclusively in the southern and border states between 1877 and the mid-60s. So basically it was a legal means of relegating or oppressing African Americans to keep them at a, on a lower rung of society, giving white Americans advantages when it came to political process, equal employment, fair housing, constitutional rights in general. Prior to Jim Crow, the Plessy versus Ferguson case is which really legalized segregation. And that was basically a case about where a man sat in a car, in a train car, and went to the Supreme Court. So now I want to talk about some crusaders for justice. We're going to get more into a modern context, into a modern era. Following civil rights legislation in the 50s and the 60s, the rest of the world was led to believe that justice had been served in the United States. Coming back from World War II in the 40s, after 45, a lot of foreigners, especially the French, lauded the efforts, and they applauded the efforts of black troops that fought alongside Europeans that were present in theaters in Europe and theaters in North Africa as well, and theaters in the Pacific, Japan. Because of that, when they come back in Europe, they received equal treatment. There were no segregation laws like there were in Europe and the United States. I mean, in Europe, like there were in the United States. So coming back to being treated, being able to eat what you want to, being treated nice, being respected, being awarded foreign medals of honor, coming back to segregation, they want to let the world know. And that really, the idea and the anger and the frustration behind that treatment is really what kicked off the civil rights movement starting in the 50s, that ended in the 60s. The black power movement challenged the belief that justice had been served in the United States after the civil rights movement. A lot of people in the black power movement did not take kindly to the scenes of dogs biting passive protesters and being beaten while they were trying to protest and work towards and labor towards the rights that they were promised on paper but were not being meted out to them. In Mexico City, this is one of the most iconic images that you're about to see, occurred at the Olympics in 1968. We had two African American 200 meter medalists, one bronze, one gold medalist. They, on top of the stand, the podium at the Olympics, when they're receiving their medals, in silent protest, they raised their fists, and you will see a lot of people do this now. They had black gloves on, no shoes, one had a necklace, a beaded necklace on, and a black scarf on. Each of these gestures symbolize something different. After they did this, one of their lives was ruined. John Carlos' life was ruined after this. He ended up teaching like high school. They were college students at the University of San Jose State University in California. Now there's a statue there commemorating them, but for 40 years, these guys got pilloried for what they did. The United States was embarrassed because to the world, they were still projecting these ideals of equality because it was on paper. Constitutionally, it looked like we had everything together. But these guys aired the dirty laundry once again after Dr. King had done so, which led to the Civil Rights and Voting Rights Act of the 60s. They were letting the world know that it's still going on. And there's a rule now that prohibits athletes from even doing any type of political activities in the Olympics. You can't do it. And it was because of these gentlemen right here. This is what it looks like. This is Tommy Smith in the middle. This is John Carlos. And this is Peter Norman. I didn't know a lot about him until I actually did some more research on this presentation. He's Australian. And what you notice that they all have on medals. They have on buttons. And there was a organization for humanity, for human rights, that they were support, that they were advocating, and he supported along with them. They wore the buttons at the Olympics. He didn't know what they were doing behind them, but it got real quiet in the stadium when they did this. When they raised the black fist, they said that the black gloves, I don't know how to commit it to memory, but I'll tell you what they said the black glove was, a statement against racial discrimination in the U.S. and human rights. They had no shoes on, and they were saying that's a representation of poverty in America, specifically in the African American community. They took the shoes off. You can see them when you look at the real picture of the shoes next to the socks. And I've seen different accounts of what the necklace and the scarf represent. One said it represents racial pride. The other, another report says that the black scarf, which you really can't see on this picture on Tommy Smith, it represented lynchings that had occurred in the United States. Now, what a lot of people probably don't realize that during the 60s, that was a bloody decade. There were a lot of assassinations. You had JFK get assassinated, I believe, in 63. You had Malcolm X was assassinated. Martin Luther King was assassinated. Chairman Fred Hampton and Mark Clark were assassinated in, I believe, 60, maybe the year after, in 69, in Chicago, in a raid by the FBI, that was spurred by the FBI. So what they were doing, what Medgar Evers was assassinated in Mississippi, who was an NAACP field secretary. So yeah, you know, and Bobby Kennedy. There were a lot of, it was a bloody year. The Freedom Riders were killed in Mississippi. These were students that were working in Mississippi trying to get people registered to vote that were killed by essentially Ku Klux Klansmen. So these guys were letting the world know, hey, this stuff's still going on. People are dying. This was their way of letting the world know. So that brings me to advocacy for equal enforcement of the law. These are organizations that all advocate civil rights and equal enforcement of the law. The NAACP was probably one of the earliest. W.E.B. Du Bois is one of the well-known founders, with Ida B. Wells, who was also an activist. But there were also two or three white Americans that were co-founders of the NAACP as well. A lot of people are not taught that. The Urban League is another organization that came about to try and help as African Americans migrated from the southern states to the north to try and, because they didn't know how that the north was as racist as the south was. It was just presented in a different fashion. You didn't have a lot of laws on the books, but the mentality was still there. They were still treated unfairly. They were still discriminated against with unfair hiring practices, and it was worse for women than it was for men. Because, the Urban League was instituted and founded to try and help African Americans integrate into urban society and advocate for them as they face discrimination in that process. The ACLU, which is not just an organization that advocates for African Americans, was instrumental in a lot of court cases in the civil rights movement. Most notably, I believe they worked with Thurgood Marshall on the Brown versus the Board of Education versus Topeka, Kansas, in 1954. The Deacons for Defense and Justice was probably them and the Panthers. I'd say probably two all-black groups. That advocated for equal enforcement of the law. The Deacons for Defense really formed out of Bogalusa, Louisiana. They formed in 64, I mean out of Jonesboro, I'm sorry. They formed in 64 to combat Klan terrorism because the police were not protecting African Americans from the Ku Klux Klan that was actually a hotbed in East Louisiana and Western Mississippi. They pretty much ran those areas through police force, through government, local government. The Black Panther Party for self-defense. The for self-defense is often left off the title, but you have to ask yourself, self-defense from who do you need to defend yourself from? One of their main duties, and they formed in Oakland, California, West Oakland, was to police the police. They rode around patrolling police because there were a lot of cases of African Americans being beaten by police, but America didn't really wake up to this fact until about 1994, when a man named Rodney King was caught on videotape being brutally beaten by four police officers in Los Angeles. That's when it seemed like, oh my God, I can't believe this is happening. They were trying to tell people like, hey, this is going on almost every day. And this was back in the 60s. They were revolutionaries. And the government, essentially the FBI is responsible for shutting them down. They had a counterintelligence program that was not only used against them, it was used against other groups as well. But they created a lot of dissent between the group and they ended up splitting. But they were a revolutionary group that believed that the government needed to be replaced, which is why they were enemies of the state. I think J. Edgar Hoover said they were probably the most dangerous group in America at one point in time. He was the leader of the head of the FBI at the time. I also want to highlight Black Lives Matter that came about probably after the death of Trayvon Martin around 2014. Now, I don't know a lot about the structure of this organization or the people behind it, and I think that they want it that way. But all of these groups throughout, what I'm trying to get you to see is you're looking at the early 1900s, the mid 1900s, mid to late, and now we're in the 21st century, and you're still having groups that are trying to advocate for equal enforcement of the law. Now, everything that I've been speaking to you about that has happened in the past to African Americans about having citizenship nominally, or just in name you have citizenship, but your rights are not being defended or asserted. People think that nowadays when people get out and protest, what are they protesting for? Don't these people have jobs? Like, why are they making all this noise? Because if you understand anything about African American history or American history in general, then you understand that equal enforcement of the law has been a problem for decades, for really for centuries. So I think the people participating in these different organizations understood that. And they're not all black. So another thing that I wanted to point out that is relevant to that work, I'm trying to get my way through this, I know I'm over time, but I think this is very important. The 13th Amendment. Does anyone know what the 13th Amendment did?
It abolished slavery.
Right. But do you think that, does everyone think that slavery has been abolished completely?
No.
No. Why not? Can somebody explain to me how it has not been abolished? One of the students. I'd like to hear from a student. Oh. Don't worry about being wrong. Like, think about it. What do you think that if people are saying that they don't think slavery has been abolished, how can slavery still exist in this country?
People have blinders on.
They have blinders on?
Yes, sir.
Where do you think slavery exists?
Everywhere. Everywhere.
In human trafficking.
Okay. Human trafficking. That's definitely one of them. Mm-hmm. But that does not speak to slavery legally existing. Mm-hmm. I'm asking about the legal existence of slavery. And for brevity's sake, I'll move along.
I would say wages.
I want you to read this for yourself. I took this from the Library of Congress's website. This is a section, part of section one of the 13th Amendment. It says, neither slavery nor involuntary servitude, except as a punishment for a crime whereof the party shall have been duly convicted, shall exist in the United States or any place to their jurisdiction. So essentially what this is saying is that slavery is still legal in the United States in jail. After you've been convicted, I'm not talking about the guys that are in the county jail fighting it that are still going to court. I'm talking about the people that the judge said, okay, you have to do 6 months, a year, 20 years of life. These people are technically legally enslaved by the United States. Now, I'm going to show you some figures, and I didn't go and get all the figures for the states. I didn't want to try and go too far down that road, but just to give you an idea. Slavery is still illegal under that amendment. Mass incarceration is a big issue in the United States. We have more prisoners in this country than any other country in the world, by far. We have exponentially more. We have millions of prisoners in the United States. The United States has more prisons than any other nation. I looked this up on a federal website. I believe on the Board of Prisons website, or the Bureau of Prisons website, there are 122 federal prisons. That's just if you're convicted of a federal crime, like these guys that sell drugs and have big drug organizations that go across state lines, or if you happen to try and shoot a public official, do something on federal property, et cetera, et cetera. Excuse me, federal crime. There are 189,214 federal inmates, and that's as of February 2nd, 2017. That's when it was last updated. We have 71,647 of those. That's 37.9% of those. Federal prisoners are African American. 110,871, or 58.6% of federal prisoners are white. And that was as of December 24, 2016. Now, we'll stop here. It looks like okay, but there's more whites in federal prison than African Americans. Like, why are African Americans making such a big deal about it? Well, African Americans are probably less than 13% of the population of this country. So when you look at that in proportion to the population of the country, that is a large disparate proportion of African Americans that are being jailed. And you have to ask yourself, why are African Americans being jailed at these rates? Well, they're committing more crimes. I'd argue more in the, with the idea that law enforcement is focused more on African-American communities. Because if you, I think everyone uses drugs. I've lived in a fluent white community, went to high school in a working class black community, in a fluent white community. Some more drugs that I've never seen in a fluent white community than I ever seen in a black community. I first seen cocaine at that school. I saw meth at that school. I saw people abusing prescription drugs at that school as opposed to the black school. All I saw was alcohol and marijuana. So from my personal experiences, I'm looking at this and I'm scratching my head like, this is a problem. Mass incarceration is a problem. It's really an extension of the American slave system. It went from chattel slavery to this. So when you hear people protesting, people out in the streets, organizations forming, people getting mad and wanting to burn up stuff and tear up buildings, even though I don't think all of those are necessarily directly associated with some of these groups that are out there, they're upset about this because I think these people understand these things. So according to the Washington Post, there were 2.3 million prisoners in the U.S. as of 2010 census. There were 3,200 local and county jails. I had read another article that said there were over 1,000 state prisons. So we're looking at probably close to 2,000 prisons and jails in this country. At the year end of 2015, there are an estimated 6,741,400 persons that were under supervision of the U.S. Adult Correction System. That's from a Federal Bureau of Justice website from the Bureau of Justice statistics. 6.7 million people that have been convicted of a crime in this country that were either on parole, probation, or incarcerated. These are not just African Americans, these are Americans. They're enslaved. When they're in jail, they work for little next to nothing. Some people get paid like a dollar and some change an hour, and I think that's considered a good job. Others might get paid 10 cents an hour. You can't live on that. They still depend on the families to send them money, most of them, to buy things in addition to what the state provides and the government provides that they need in them, that the taxpayers ultimately pay for. That's another thing. Taxpayers pay for a lot of the inmates' supplies and health care that are in public jails, like your city jails, state prisons. A lot of these, but the big problem is, and the thing I want you all to consider, is a lot of these jails, prisons especially, are being privatized. So now you have private people that are owning these prisons that are making profit off the labor of these enslaved prisoners. And you're looking at the numbers of Americans, the proportion, the disparate numbers of African Americans and other minorities that are being incarcerated, then you have to look at the slavery thing in a whole other context. You have to look at the Constitution. I think it forces us to look at the Constitution in a whole other context. So, and these are just some more statistics that I found about people that the numbers of people enslaved that are on parole or probation. So another thing that I want to highlight is that not knowing your history as an American, as an African American, can make it put you in a position where you're easily misled. You may read your textbook and overlook a lot of things. Like coming from California, which is on the opposite spectrum politically than Texas, it's an extreme liberal state, this being a more conservative state, I see a lot of things. I saw a lot of things here that a lot of African Americans, I'm just like, that doesn't bother you? Like, Texas, boy, hey, boy, somebody calling me boy is very offensive. Because during the Civil Rights Movement, when we had soldiers coming back from World War II, they were men. They had medals on their chest, they had Purple Hearts, came back with bullets in their body, maimed. They earned the right to be called men, even though they were men before they went. They earned that. They came back to being called boy. During Jim Crow, you have my grandmother is back here, right back here in this red. My grandmother's 90 years old. I hope you don't mind me saying that, big mama. But during the Jim Crow era, a 16-year-old white man could call her gal. And that's common. So when you read, like for me, seeing things like this and noticing things like this, I had a big problem with it. And what I found interesting was there was this book that was published by McGraw-Hill. It came out in Texas, state of Texas, issued to high school. A graduate student from the University of Houston, where I attended, son found this in their book. She snapshotted it and sent it to the mutual media outlet. It's kind of small. I wanted to see if you guys could figure out what was wrong with this picture, but I don't think that you can really read all of this. But I highlighted what was really kind of offensive in this picture in the next slide. And here it says, the Atlantic slave trade between the 1500s and the 1800s brought millions of workers from Africa to the southern United States to work on agricultural plantations. Before I pointed out, can anybody see anything that's wrong with that statement?
Workers.
They use the term workers. So workers say it out loud.
Instead of slave.
Right.
And they're like, it's okay, they're workers.
Right. So if you're not really aware of the history, of the way that history is being written, we call that historiography in the discipline of history. Historiography is basically the history of history, how a narrative changes over time. And that's often influenced by social conditions, politically correct terms, basically the general feeling of the people of a region or a nation dictates how history is written. So if you don't understand how the history of slavery in this country, what it actually meant as an institution, slavery was not an event. It was an actual long-standing institution. And when you start looking at slavery and the evolution of slavery and sharecropping into the Jim Crow era with these unequal enforcement of laws, you start understanding that things like this are a problem because if you forget, if you allow someone to gradually erase it from history, from the textbooks, then you'll fall for this and just and look at it as, you'll look at slavery as a bunch of workers. 50 years from now, I imagine if this goes unchecked, then they say immigrants brought from Africa. Like people just willfully came over here to pick cotton and tobacco for free. Like, so these are things that I found problematic, that I think that having a knowledge of American history, of African-American history, will allow us to catch, to be mindful of, and to correct so that people that either overlook this or aren't mindful of, or that intentionally want us to believe this, cannot be successful in doing so. I don't think that we should ever forget our history as African-Americans. I don't think that America should ever disregard its treatment of African-Americans because, albeit we came here under adverse conditions that were probably some of the most deplorable conditions in the history of any nation that I can think of, we are becoming, and still integrating further into the society, but we've become a very valuable part of society because I don't honestly think that this country would be in the shape that it is, or the country that it is, without African Americans. W.E.B. Du Bois says that the labor that was the backbone of this nation, that was the economic backbone of this nation, was founded upon slave labor. And the assistance that helped the United States win the Revolutionary War from France was purchased with tobacco that was raised by African slaves. So what I want us to all keep in mind is that understanding our history directly correlates to these, to, in a modern context, to things like revisionist history that you may see in a book like this, or with through the activism of modern day young people. And a lot of this activism, the Black Panther Party, the Black United Students movement at Kent State that started first recognizing African American history month, these were students. The John Carlos and Tommy Smith that protested the Olympics were students. They were in their early 20s. They were students at San Jose State University. These were people that understood things about philosophy and history, and they were able to address societal issues, social issues that were plaguing the country. A lot of the students that worked with Dr. King, with the Congress on Racial Equality, that was with SNCC, the Student Nonviolence Coordinating Committee, that came to the southern states that were advocating and pushing for integration in public spaces and voter registration drives, were students. So as students, this is something to take serious, because if you don't get it while you're students, once you get into the workforce, you have children, you have a mortgage, car payments, you're going to be a lot less likely to pick up a book and read about something like this because you're going to be worried about paying bills. So on that note, I would like to conclude my presentation on Black History Month as an American history. If anyone has any questions, if we have time, I don't know, I know well over time, but if anyone has any questions, feel free to come and ask me, or can we take it going forward?
What would people say and ask you? Okay.
Okay, I am so sorry for keeping you all.
No, it's okay.